The name Milton Lee Olive III can be seen all over American cities, from the Milton L. Olive Middle School in Long Island, New York, to the Olive Park on Lake Michigan in Chicago. Olive Harvey College, one of the city colleges of Chicago, is named after both Olive and fellow Medal of Honor recipient Carmel B. Harvey. Milton Lee Olive III was born near Ebenezer, Holmes County, Mississippi. His mother had died at childbirth, and he later moved to Chicago to live with his father and stepmother. Milton's life has had an impact on many people's lives. 20 years after returning from Vietnam, Robert Toporek, a former squad member and friend of Milton, talked to his parents in Chicago. Milton's father told Toporek about all the places that had been named after Milton. Robert was moved that Milton was having an impact on more people in his death than Toporek was making for people alive. He decided that he needed to expand the difference he was already making.
Hi, I'm Robert Toporek. I'm an advanced certified rolfer. I'm also president and founder of Team Children. I also studied with Dr. Rolf and am the founder of the project to begin to teach people how to rolf babies and children. I was also a member of the 173rd Airborne Brigade. We were one of the first ground combat troops in Vietnam. I quit high school and joined the Army, and I was trained as an infantryman, and I actually wanted to be in Special Forces. The Army didn't tell me that you had to have a high school degree to be in Special Forces, so I became a paratrooper and was sent to Vietnam. The way I tell the story is that my first job in Vietnam was the company commander's Jeep driver and radio operator. And tell you the truth, I was horrible. I had no idea what I was doing. And after screwing up about 4 or 5 times, they said, "We got to get rid of this guy, put him back in the third platoon." And the way I explained what it was like was that there were a bunch of black boys and a bunch of white boys in a tent together, and there was no counselor. All the other people seemed to have sorted out whatever differences they had, and they were all fine with one another, but Milton Olive and I just seemed to irritate the hell out of each other. And like all boys in those days did to solve the problem, we went behind our tent and we just beat the hell out of each other. When the fight was over, my experience was that we were then brothers, and there were no longer black boys and white boys in a tent together. They were simply men whose lives depended on each other.
Milton Olive sacrificed his life in battle for our country and freedom. Posthumously awarded the highest American military decoration, Milton was the 8th African American and the first in the Vietnam War to receive the Medal of Honor. Milton was only 18 years of age, serving as a private first class in Vietnam.
So I don't remember how long it was, maybe a month, maybe 2 months after that fight. We were on a mission, and I happened to be, I believe, right behind him at the moment or very close by. Our squad leader thought he heard something off to the side. He called me over there to go with him to explore it. I did not really want to go, but he insisted. And so we started going that way, they started going that way. Not more than a minute or two later, the entire jungle erupted in gunfire and screams and bullets, and shrapnel was flying all over the place, and we hit the ground, and I think it was Sergeant Fletcher. And we ended up, after a while, that quieted down. We got back to where everybody was, and there was Milton lying face down with his guts hanging out of the right side of his body. And I was sitting there looking at him, and somebody yells, "Don't just look at him, put him on a poncho and let's get him out of there." So I happened to be one of the people that had to scoop his body back together, help put him on a poncho, and help carry him out of the jungle.
On October 22, 1965, while moving through the jungle with his battalion in the Fukang province, Olive gave his life by covering an enemy-thrown live grenade with his body.
About half of our squad or platoon either got killed or wounded. I don't remember all of them, but Milton was one, and a guy named Beauchamp was another. One day we're on a mission. It was my turn to be the point man. A guy named Beauchamp argued that he wanted to go first. He went first. I was right behind him. As we walked up the Ho Chi Minh Trail, just as he turned the corner, he got killed. The entire jungle again erupted in gunfire and explosions, and we were being attacked by an entire regiment of North Vietnamese regulars. There was a moment in time when there was just me and the enemy, and I knew that if I got out of there alive, that God had some purpose for me. So I did get out of there alive. I was given the Bronze Star and the Vietnamese Cross of Gallantry and a Purple Heart for what I did that day. And I decided to, war was not a good thing, and there had to be some better way to solve humanity's problems. So that my commitment was to find my way of making a difference in life. After my first tour of duty, I remember being in the non-commissioned officer's lounge one day, watching a video on snow training at Fort Carson, Colorado in the wintertime, and infantry. And that did not look like fun to me. And for some odd reason, about a month later, I got my orders to go back to the United States, and it said, oh my God, Fort Carson, Colorado, oh my God, in the wintertime. And I went back to, I don't know, somebody in the headquarters and said, hey, I can't do this, what can I do? And they said, well, just stay here. So a friend of mine had volunteered to stay for an extra 6 months. I said, what the hell? I did, and one of the things that happened was that our platoon leader was now our company sergeant major, and he was going to be leaving soon. He decided he did not want to leave me back in the field. So they gave me a job being a Jeep driver for our ex-platoon leader, who was also our ex-company commander, and it was a civil affairs program. So Captain Johnson ran that program for a couple weeks. I drove him around. I just sat in the Jeep while he went and did whatever he did. And he came out one day and he said, well, Sergeant DePort, you're going to be in charge. I said, what do you mean? He said, I'm going to Guadalupar to set up an R&R system, and they'll replace me sometime soon, but in the meantime, you're in charge, and I'll take you around and show you what we're doing. So they never did send anybody until about 11 months later, and during that year, I was in charge of our entire battalion civil affairs program. We built a couple schools, we built a playground, we built a Boy Scout lodge, we built a health center where we treated refugees once a week. We got doctors come in and volunteer their time. We took kids to the dentist because we had dentists that were volunteering their times on Saturdays. And then we had a little project where we taught kids how to do read English and stuff like that.
9,087,000 military personnel served on active duty during the Vietnam era, August 5th, 1964 through May 7th, 1975. Another 50,000 men served in Vietnam between 1960 and 1964. 75,000 were severely disabled. 23,214 were classified 100% disabled. 5,283 lost limbs, and 1,081 sustained multiple amputations. 87% of the men who were killed in action were Caucasian. 12% were black, and 1% belonged to other races. Milton Olive is buried in the West Grove Baptist Church Cemetery, Lexington, Mississippi.
When I came back from Vietnam, I went to college a little bit, still didn't find formal schooling my cup of tea. I ended up working in a poverty program for a year, teaching adult illiterates how to read and do math and go on job interviews. I was really good at it. The next year, I was hired to set up a program like that for rural farm workers. I worked for a guy named Jim Clyburn, who's now in the United States House of Representatives. I ran for public office a couple times. That was one of my things. I think I ran for city council. And then I got a fellowship from the Ford Foundation to do whatever I wanted to in the domain of researching personal growth and public education. I wanted to see if there was any relationship to what way people were teaching actually caused people to be better human beings. And basically, I found out that for the most part, standing in line and waiting your turn and raising your hand are not things that really foster the full development of human beings. Then I went to San Francisco. I did a year of meditation and spiritual exercises with a group called Eureka. And while I was there, they suggested I become a Rolfer because a lot of those people had been Rolfed and they said I had really good hands. And I applied to the Rolf Institute, and I really had always wanted to study directly with Dr. Rolf, and I got an opportunity to do that the last 4 years of her life. So I started a project of Rolfing kids in a ghetto, one of the worst drug neighborhoods of Philadelphia. Along with that, we started distributing books, we built a playground, and then I came up with the bright idea that we would distribute computers. So at one point, I got a bunch of my clients who were in the computer world to give me computers. They gave me computers, we repaired them, we gave them to the people in the neighborhood, and it was really awesome. And since that time, I've been fascinated with the possibility of making a difference for children through technology. And although I can't Rolf all the poor children in the world, we can begin to bring some of those ideas into their community. And one of them is that we're distributed over 11,000 computers. We've reached more than 50,000 children. We've created a relationship with the Institutes for the Achievement of Human Potential, AWE Learning Systems, which has given us permission to put their ELF on our computers, and Brill Kids from Hong Kong, which has given us permission to put their software on our computers. And we're out to just make as much of a difference for as many children as we possibly can as quickly as possible.
My name is Brendan Kelly.
Hi, I'm Daniela Chifo.
My name is Eric Drummy.
I'm Mason Humphrey.
Hi, I'm Julie.
My name is Erica Rosendez.
My name is Whitney Tatum.
Teen Children's vision is to transform preschool education and the opportunity is provided to people.
I definitely think that our vision is something that will remain relevant for many years to come because society is moving forward at such a fast rate as far as the technology aspect of it goes. I mean, it's just amazing.
Hey, the vision of Teen Children is for every child to have a computer to help them in school and to help them be the best they can be.
Teen Children, an Audubon, Pennsylvania-based nonprofit organization, is committed to ensure that every child is given the tools and opportunity to compete and contribute effectively in today's global economy.
So we don't have the time, you know, to be every day on top of this, but Robert has dedicated himself, and I want you all to hear this, because he's doing it, and he's not expecting any, you know, he hasn't expected a payment or anything like that. He's just doing it because he believes in it. And I wanted to publicly thank him in front of you because I don't think I've ever done that. So I do want to please give him an applause.
Well, over the years, I have been participating in my own transformation. And I've had to ongoingly deal with myself to be able to make what I'm doing a contribution. I think it's a huge leap to go from being trained to kill people to being trained to cure people or to heal people or to make something possible for people that was never possible before. And I don't know, had I never had that experience of war, I don't think I would have my passion for peace that I have today.